Good day, everyone. So we're going to go over the second problem with regards to a hypothesis test for one population mean mu. So here's our problem. So an administrator at the University of Akron is concerned how long it takes students who commute to find a parking space once they get to campus. He wants to test whether it takes more than 300 seconds, meaning 5 minutes, to find a spot once on campus. He randomly selects 100 commuters, and the mean time for them to find a parking spot is 310.4 seconds, the standard deviation of 80 seconds. So test the claim, and we're going to set the alpha, the significance level, to 5% or 0.05. So let's go through the background information. So what's our variable? Time to park, right? Time to park is quantitative. You know, how long did it take you to park today, right? And so that's the thing that's varying from person to person or thing to thing, right? And you would answer that with a number. It's quantitative. So how are we going to analyze quantitative stuff? With means. What's our sample? We had a sample who randomly selects 100 commuters. All right, so that's n. So our degrees of freedom is 99 and minus 1. That means our population is all UA commuters. Makes sense. So our sample mean turned out to be the 310.4. Now, why is that? It says, okay, randomly selects 100 commuters, and the mean time for them to find a parking space spot. Is that number right there? That's x bar. Okay. Sample standard deviation is right after that with a standard deviation of 80 seconds. So that's s. Okay. And alpha was set to 0.05. All right. So again, where did these numbers come from? Where did that come from? Well, we have numbers for each one of these commuters. You know, the first commuter, maybe it took 290 seconds. The next commuter took 210 seconds. Next one took 40 seconds. Next one took 400 seconds. Okay, and so you got 100 of those, and we averaged them just like we did in chapter 2. We took the standard deviation of those numbers. That turned out to be 80. Okay, that's where those numbers are coming from. We've already synthesized those numbers. We've already calculated them. Okay. So instead of giving you the data for all 100 commuters, we just went ahead and said, well, here are the numbers, okay? Assuming that you know kind of where those are coming from, right? Because we've talked about that way back in chapter 2, all right? All right, so state the hypotheses. What do we always start with? We always start with the alternative. And it says here he wants to test whether it takes more than, 300 seconds. Now, we're not going to put 5 minutes, right? I can put 5 minutes. And the reason why is because all this stuff was in terms of seconds, right? So we're not going to put it in minutes. That was just to tell you how, you know, in terms of minutes, how far it was. But we're going to put it in terms of seconds, 300 and more than. So we're going to have the alternative is mu is greater than 300. Now, we could have written this out in words. We could have said the mean time takes commuters to find a parking spot once on campus, okay, for all commuters. That's mu, all right? We could have written all that out, but we tend to be, you know, use some shorthand with stuff in mathematics and statistics, and so we're just saying here, for the problem, it's mu, all right? The null, mu is equal to 300, all right? And so this value right here is mu sub 0. That's mu sub 0. And so mu sub 0 is equal to 300. All right, hopefully that all makes sense. What's the second step? Verify our conditions, right? And if we have any assumptions. And so, first condition, we took a random sample right here. Randomly selects, right? Two, there is no mention of any outliers. That's more of an assumption here, okay? In practice, we would take a look at a histogram and see if we have any extreme outliers, okay? And these problems right here, you would expect not to hear anything about outliers because we wouldn't know how to handle it if we did. And then the next one would be that since n is equal to 100, that's greater than or equal to 30, what's applying? The CLT, the central limit theorem, and that means the sampling distribution of x bar is what? Approximately normal. It takes on a t distribution. All right, moving on. Step 3, calculate the test stat. And so let's go through the pieces parts again. So we have an n of 100. We have a sample mean of x, you know, an x bar of 310.4. We have a sample standard deviation of 80. And there's our value in the null hypothesis. Okay, so I think we have everything that we need. All right, So let's go ahead and put in the values. So we got 310.4 minus 300. That's mu sub 0. There's s, there's n. All right. And remember, when you put in your calculator, parentheses here, and probably it'd be a good idea to put parentheses down here too. Okay. And don't forget two division signs. So 310.4 minus 300 in parentheses divided by, in parentheses, 80 divided by square root of 100. Okay. I got here 1.30 for your test stat. So what does that mean? The x bar that we got from our sample is what? 1.30 standard errors above the value in what? In the null hypothesis. Okay. So I didn't write that out, but that's our interpretation, and it hasn't changed. Okay. All right. So what's next? We got to go figure out the p-value. Remember, we have a right-tailed test because we are testing if mu is greater than 98.6. Right-tailed test. And so, oh, that's an awful line, but we'll have to deal with it. All right. My goodness, I am so disappointed in that. I'm just going to have to do that again. My. Good, we can start over. All right. See if I can do a better job. Well, we're just going to have to deal with it there. That wasn't too bad. All right. So here's the t distribution. Here is 0. Then we got what? 1, 2, 3. And remember, there's a little bit more area in the tail in the t distribution, so we're going to go out 4. So 1.30 is, I don't know, maybe about right there. Okay, and so we got this entire area to figure out with regards to the p-value. And again, we can't look on our t-table. It's not precise enough to give us our p-value. And so what are we going to do? We're going to go to StatCrunch now. For homework, that you're going to have to go to StatCrunch to do this. For on the exam, we would just give you the p-value for this t-test. Okay, and rest assured that that's what's going to happen. All right, so let's get out of this. Sorry for the noise. Let's see, we'll keep that. And we'll go over to StatCrunch. So we'll go to Stat, Calculators, and we come down to the t-distribution. So we'll move this over. Put in our 99 degrees of freedom. Oh, we got to change this to greater than. All right. And our test statistic. Take it to two decimal places so that your test stat goes here. So we got 1.30. We'll go ahead and hit compute, and we got here 0.0983. And since the next number is 0, we can just kind of chop it off right there. Okay, rounding properly. Now you don't have to take 1 minus anything. Okay, StatCrunch has already calculated it directly for you. Okay, you know, you only have to do that with the tables, right? Tables don't know what you want. Well, StatCrunch does because you told it greater than. Okay, so we got 0.0983 for our p-value. All right, and there's our, I'll get back into the slideshow here. All right, so when we go to the next line here, there's our p-value, 0.0983, and that is this area right there. So that represents about 10%, you know, roughly 10% of the area underneath that curve. All right, so our conclusion. What do we always compare the p-value to? We always compare it to alpha. Alpha was set to 0.05. So let's see, the p-value of 0.0983 does not provide considerable evidence. Okay, does not provide, all right? Since it's greater than alpha of 0.05. Okay, so what are we going to say? We're going to say do not reject the null. Remember, don't say accept the null. We're not accepting the null, okay? It's a possibility. What's also a possibility? The alternative, and we don't know which one it is. So the statements and the null and the alternative hypotheses are still plausible. They're still possible. We just don't know which one it is. So what's going to be our final conclusion written out? We're going to say we do not have strong evidence. We do not have sufficient evidence. We do not have statistically significant evidence. Okay. If you want to go ahead and state your level of alpha at the 5% significance level, at the mean time for all UA commuting students to find a parking space, so that's mu, is what? It's greater than 300 seconds. So we do not have strong evidence of that. Even though X bar was slightly above 300, okay, we can't say for certain, okay, that mu is going to be for the entire population. Remember, mu is for the entire population, okay? And X bar is just for that 100 commuters, okay? It is a possibility that mu still could be, what, under 300 at this point, okay? And so we're getting close to maybe rejecting the null, but not quite, all right? So hopefully that'll get you through another problem. Now, I got one more slide. The last slide is that what happens if we have a p-value for a two-tailed test? So the last problem, the p-value was 0.0983, okay? Now, if the problem was a two-tailed test, so if HA had a not equal to sign, we didn't have it here, we had a greater than sign, but if HA had a not equal to sign, meaning we have a two-tailed test, what are we simply going to do since we're figuring out, remember what's happening here, is that for a two-tailed test, you would have to figure out this tail, and you would have to figure out this tail. Well, for the t-distribution, that's exactly the same. So once you find the one of the tails, okay, you just multiply it by 2 or add it to itself, and you would go ahead and get your p-value for the two-tailed test. And so you would multiply this by 2, okay? And what would you get? You get something like, see, what would that be? 6, 6, looks like 9, 1, 0.1, 9, 6, 6. All right, and so I didn't want to basically go through a two-tailed test when it wasn't necessary, because that's the only change, okay, is that when you get to the p-value, you multiply the one tail by 2, and there you go, okay? So hopefully that will get you through all of this section. Thank you for your time.